To the south of the United States lies our grand neighbor, South America. Brazil is almost as large as our country. In the heart of this large continent is Bolivia, a country of 6 million people and approximately the same size as Texas. The lofty Andes cross its face like a giant scar. As in a dream, Eastern Flight 980 arrives at the highest airport in the world, El Alto, at 13,320 feet. On January 1st, 1985, Flight 980 did not arrive. It died on the slopes of Mount Illimani. El Alto Airport serves the city of La Paz, or City of Peace, resting high amongst the clouds and home to over 1 million people. It is the highest capital in the world, sitting on a 13,000-foot perch, trapped between Mount Huayna Potosí and the Altiplano, or High Plain. In the distance, Mount Illimani, an extinct volcano, rests peacefully in the noonday sun, beautiful but deadly. Under the blue canopy of crystal clear air, the citizens of La Paz go about their daily chores. The people respect Mount Illimani. Under its pure mantle of snow, rivers of blood have run. 4 aircraft and more than 70 souls lie in the icy grip of its eternal snows. This is a radio navigation map showing the route between Asunción, Paraguay, and La Paz. On January 1st, 1985, the crew of Flight 980 followed this route. At 8:27 in the evening, they contacted La Paz control and said that they were at 35,000 feet. At 8:37, they reported checkpoint Tacón, 55 miles from La Paz. At 8:38, La Paz control cleared 980 to descend from 35,000 feet to 18,000 feet. 980 acknowledged. Those were the very last words. At 8:45, the king of a microphone was heard, then silence forever. At the lower right-hand side of the chart, just outside the map area, checkpoint Tacón is depicted. The long line to the left, with a larger aircraft, is the correct route. The line to the right is the projected route that ended on the slopes of Mount Illimani, only 26 miles from the airport. Flight 980. I had flown the trip many times before. Some of the crew members were my friends. The first expedition after the accident only remained 2 hours at the site. They had no camera, and the only photographs of the site were in black and white. These photographs were taken from an aircraft and show almost no detail. There was only speculation concerning the cause of the accident. I wanted to search for the truth. Opportunity came in the form of Ronnie Ibata, an architect from La Paz and an expert mountain climber. Plans were swiftly made, logistics studied. The time was ripe on March 15, 1985. It was on this date that my vigil began. Ronnie had flown around the crash site in a military aircraft the day after the accident. His curiosity was aroused. The mountain was calling. He listened and answered. The road twisted and turned about the mountain. Illimani already threatens with its devious, hidden power. finally the end of the road. No more transportation. From here, only human endurance would carry the burden as we started the climb to the top. The first night, we have a quarter moon and a million stars for companionship. La Paz is a jewel as it reflects the sun. In the morning, we break camp and again begin to climb. This area is called the Stairway to Heaven. We arrive at Condor's Nest. The temperature is now 20 degrees. A view of Mount Mururata, or mountain without a head. The North Peak, 21,000 feet. The temperature is now 5 degrees below zero. Finally, at the top, the wind gusts to 40 miles per hour. At this altitude, the body needs more oxygen, but the cold makes it impossible to breathe deeply without damaging your lungs. Every step is painful. We start down the reverse slope. In the distance, the first glimpse of metal glistens against the snow. The heartache begins. The largest piece found is the tail of the aircraft. It lies upside down on the snow about 250 feet from the impact point. So very close to La Paz, and yet an eternity away. The impact point is located at approximately 19,000 feet. The aircraft collided with a glacier at about a 65 degree angle. It cartwheeled on its back and blew apart. Wreckage was strewn on a line 1,200 feet long and 150 feet wide. In the foreground, a section of the flaps. The aft end of an engine cowling. bits and pieces of the aircraft cover a large area. Clothing is scattered about. The aircraft carried a large cargo of serpent skins for making shoes. They can be found everywhere. We searched the area by inserting a long rod into the snow. Whenever resistance was met, the digging began. At times, we would push the rod down and it would come back up. We discovered that the serpent skins had a sponge effect that would push the rod back up. A chart showing radio facilities in the United States and South America. This chart is carried in the cockpit. Ronnie has placed next to the chart one of the original pictures taken of the crash, one day after the accident. The Eastern logo on the upper part of the fuselage. A further climb takes us to the pieces of the aft section. The tail itself was only 250 feet from the impact point, but some of the aft sections are 800 feet away. There was no fire, but all the articles that were brought back are permeated with a heavy stench of jet fuel, even after all this time. Ronnie calls this odor the perfume of death. Absolutely no human remains were found. In a suitable area overlooking the devastation, Ronnie deposited a cross made with flowers and a silver leaf plaque with an inscription. If you expect death as a friend, prepare to entertain him. If as an enemy, prepare to overcome him. Death has no advantage except when he comes as a stranger. And so he came to the souls of Flight 980. One life, a little gleam of time between two eternities. No second chance for them forevermore.